The homeless are still homeless. The poor are still poor. Yet we find billions of dollars to fund senseless war. And yes, we're fighting terrorism. What about the quiet racism? Dividing among ourselves. Somebody's crying for help. Heaven is listening. Heaven is watching. Heaven knows.
Hello, my friend. I'm Gloria Mitchell with good news for you. Today, I have some good news that's coming across the oceans, or the seas, we would say. It's coming from Nairobi, Kenya. And so, as we look at what has happened in our country in the last week, in the election, post-election, presidential election of 2016, I have someone who is going to encourage you, because our message today is that there are two times when we are to praise God. We praise Him when we feel like it, and we praise Him when we don't. And so we're going to praise God anyhow. So, Pastor George Thiongo, are you there?
I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm ready.
Speak to us, Pastor George Thiongo. Tell us where you are, and tell us about your ministry.
Okay. Praise the Lord, wherever you are in America. I'm Pastor George Thiongo. And I'm in Nairobi, Kenya, in the capital of Nairobi. I minister with Agape Fellowship Ministry. I'm blessed with one wife and three boys. That's Roland, Sammy, and Joseph. And we are situated in slums of Kwaruben. And we thank God for being there. Praise the Lord that the Lord has connected us with Gloria. And also, with this such a great station, that we may speak to our brother and sister in America, because always we are connected with you. God bless you as you continue to hear from us.
Okay. Well, thank you for that. So we have you, Pastor George. Now, what we want to do is, first of all, I just want you to get a bit of the mood for where we are right now. I know you're watching television, but I also get to interact and mingle and talk with those around me. And some have one opinion and others have, of course, their own opinion. And so some are feeling that the election was not fair, and they're wondering how in the world would God allow an arrogant or prideful or boastful person to be exalted to the highest position in the land. And then yet there are others who are saying, oh no, we couldn't possibly have a woman in leadership. Or others would say, no, we've already had a dynasty of that particular family. Now we want something new and different. But what we have seen is that there are problems that have surfaced that show us that these United States are not nearly as united as we probably thought they were. In other words, there's a split right down the middle. And so that takes me to our scripture, which has to do with the people of Israel asking Samuel for a king. Samuel was old. And so the people went to Samuel and said, you're old, and your sons are not walking in your way. They're not walking in the ways of the Lord. They're accepting bribes and they're perverting justice. And so we want a king. And Samuel prayed to the Lord, and the Lord said, oh, they want a king? Give them a king. And so they got what they wanted, because they asked for it. Because the Lord said, they didn't reject you and what you were doing. They rejected me. And so I can just imagine that the people were grieving when Saul did not turn out to be the type of king that they thought he would be, or things were not the way they would anticipate. So with that being said, I'd like to hear from you some things that you would share with us to encourage those who might feel a bit down or disenfranchised because they might be poor, and in your case, you're in the slums where they're poor blacks. Speak to us, please.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much for such a good question. I would like for us to say that the things of God, sometimes they are secret. The things of God, sometimes they are in secret.
They are
nobody
what?
Could imagine.
I'm sorry, I missed
nobody.
That. Sometimes they are what?
Sometimes the things of God, they are in a secret manner.
Okay, all right. In a secret manner, you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
You can check in the book of Deuteronomy, 29 verse 29.
Go ahead.
Deuteronomy 29:29. It says, the secret things belong to the Lord our God. But those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do and would also of this law. So the point here, Moses was trying to talk to the children of Israel, as you have mentioned, that the time came and the people, they were demanding, they need a king, they need a king. And it was so sad because God says, for the king that you are looking for, he might become a problem to your children, and the people did not mind. But as I take the issue concerning the U.S., the Hillary and the Trump, my point is that there are some of the things that are in God's secret. And those things which are in God's secret, the Bible says they belong to God. Those who feel they did not do what they were wishing or what they were expecting to do, number one, they should let God take control. Because the Bible says in the book of Romans, if God is on our side, who can be against us? So here, people need to be patient, because always, all over the world, the change is coming. Remember, we are approaching to the end time, when we shall see different things happening and things happening. So people should understand which time and a moment we are living. And we are living in the time that everything is becoming wicked. So it is my prayer that the people of America, those who fear God, who trust in God, who depend on God, nobody will be able to harm them, because if they continue to call upon God, God will secure them. But they're going to see some changes, some differences. But my prayer is that the revealed things belong to, the secret things belong to God. But whatever is revealed, the Bible says it is us and for our children. So let each and everyone there be encouraged and know nobody can overrun God. God is in control. God loves America. God is for America. God who stands for America. If it is the time for judgment, it is my prayer that the saint should cry like Ezra. They repent for the sin, them that know and them that doesn't know, so that God will revive America and that America will become back as it was. So nobody should worry, because God, it is in control.
All right. That's a wonderful word. I thank you for sharing that. And also over there in Kenya, have you had a chance to hear some feedback from some of the people there as to what their impression is of what's happening here in America?
Yeah, even here in Kenya, people were divided. Some, they were saying so-and-so will take control. The woman cannot, they say America is a superpower. It needs somebody who is sober, somebody who has a big heart. And some were saying, Hillary might be having experience. Others, they are saying, okay, a woman is a woman. But now they are saying, because the election is over and America, they have spoken. So we give them time, waiting to see how the things will be. But our prayer as an Africa is America is part of us, and we cannot keep quiet. We'll continue praying, interceding for America. And remember, Gloria, there is power in prayer.
Yes.
There is power in prayer. Prayer can change the State House in America, White House. Prayer can put things in order, because the prayer is only the tool that can bring the difference. So let the people rise up. Whoever fear, whoever doesn't fear, this is the time to pray, because America cannot go down as the saints stand.
That's a wonderful word that you mentioned about prayer. Even in the passage from 1 Samuel 8:1-7 that I talked about earlier, I saw there that wickedness abounded. It was wickedness that made the people rise up. Wicked leadership made the people rise up. And then the people gathered together and they demanded change because of the wicked leadership. And that's when they asked for a king. Well, God gave them what they wanted because Samuel prayed. So prayer made the difference, and it moved the heart of God. And then also, God told Samuel, and we need to know that, that no matter what we've taught, no matter what the Bible says, if we tell the truth, that's all that God requires of us. And so God said, Samuel, the people haven't rejected you and what you've been teaching them. They have rejected me. And so in America, our motto is, in God we trust. Well, we don't see a lot of trusting in God, it looks like. It looks like people are trusting more in government, trusting more in money and things and anything other than God. And of course, the Lord says, I will have no other gods before me. He told us not to do that, to put none before him. And so I believe, and just like you said, the time for judgment is here. But there's something we can do. He tells us in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, that's just the Christians, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Our land needs a healing. Amen. Actually, we need a revival. We need a revival to start right here in America and spread all out all over the world. We're praying for revival.
Yes.
What do you say?
Thank you.
Go ahead. Great. What do you say about that?
Yes. As the Bible says, that if my people who are called by my name, they'll pray and seek and turn from their wicked, the Lord is saying he will hear them and heal thy land. You know, America has been superpower for a long time. America has been, nobody was thinking that we can see riots. We were in the TV looking for America. We saw different things that the African could not think can happen.
Yes.
But this shows that nobody can depend by its own power. America should come back to God. America should cry to God, because the time for coming back to God, it is now, not tomorrow. The Bible says he is a God of today. Today I have told the people that he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. America has been put in a good foundation. The generation of today in America, they need to know that it is only through God who can change the situation. And such a leader that you have chosen, it is my prayer that the people should know they need to go back unto God.
Well, since we're talking about praising God when we feel like it and praising him when we don't, I know that you've shared with us some encouraging words for those who are feeling weary or might feel down. But I also know that you have a church full of praising worshipers and people who praise you. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to play a video. It's a short video clip of folks praising God, and then I'll come back, okay? So listen in. Don't just hold on, okay?
Hallelujah.
Okay, go ahead. Okay. All right. So your folks were dancing and they were shouting and they were playing music and singing. So tell me, how is it that people can praise the Lord like that in the place where you are? I've got to put up also a picture of some little girls standing in front of the church. But tell us how they can praise God in spite of their circumstances.
You know, the Bible says that God dwells in the presence of his people. And we have come to discover, no matter the poverty, sicknesses, the trouble, the needs that are surrounding us, because we are so different here in Africa, that we have come to discover, the Bible says, we seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things that we would need, the Lord gonna supply. That's why we have come to this revelation that there is power in praise, and God himself, he dwells in the presence of his people. So that's why you see us, we can praise from all our hearts, because we have no any other trust, because the Bible says we should not bow to any god. We should not worship any idol. Neither we should not put our trust to any man. So our trust, our faith, we depend upon God. And that's why each and every person, young to small, big to fat to thinner, all of us, we need to praise God, because it is only God who can change our life, our situation, and everything we are going through. So we are here, and we have seen God moving in our midst.
Yes, and I've seen him moving in the ministry too. I'm going to put up a picture next of a classroom full of young people. And I know that instead of just preaching to them and sending them home, you also have founded a school. Would you tell us about that, please?
Yes, after being in the midst, in the center of the slums, in the center of the needy people, there was a time that we came to say that wherever we are, people, they are coming from different area, coming with a heart looking for green pastures. And we saw how the children were being left at home, nobody to care for them, nobody to teach them. And my wife decided to have a small class. We started with one child. Then we went two, three, and now we have more than 300 children.
Oh,
why?
My goodness.
Because of the 300 children. And we feed them, we teach them. We have more than 12 teachers that we are helping the children together with all the needy, but with the trusting and depending God. And through somebody like you and others who have a heart for the children, who knows that the future, it is in the children. They lend their heart. So even now we are saying that we are not yet. By year 2017, we are hoping that we can go to more and reach more people, because the area, as you have seen through the picture, it is not a big space. But we use what we have, because the Bible says, God asked Moses, what do you have? And Moses says, I have only a stick. So what we have, that is what we are helping such as children. We have the church where we are teaching the family, the young people, the people who are affected by different diseases, the people who are marriage are getting broken. We are there to encourage the people and to tell the people, if the hope can get lost through people, there is hope in Christ. There is hope in Jehovah. So this is why we help the children And now, by 2017, we'll be having the first candidate from young to such a class 7. They'll be doing a national exam in our center. So we praise the Lord for how he is moving with the ministry that he has given unto us.
Okay, so your vision then for the future are, I know that in 1 year you expanded from a daycare center all the way up to sixth and seventh grade. What is your vision for the future?
After this, that's our prayer, that if God can give us a good life, God can give us the people who have a heart like we have, so that we can reach out to more children, we'll be able to look for a big land, then we can build for a center, whereby after they finish for a kindergarten, that primary school up to class 8, then they can go for secondary school, where they can sleep there, they can board there, so that we can have the people who can give them counseling, teach them, prepare them for the best future. Today, I have told my leader that the change is coming because technology and the people who are learning in Africa, they are becoming more and more than the time we have passed. So there is future as God raised the people. Even in America, they need to rise up from a comfort zone and know their brothers and their sisters, they are crying, saying, where are you? Where are your support? We need to encourage you, but also you need to stand with us and say that we know that you have such a need, we can stand and help somebody. Somebody who helped one child, he doesn't know whether he is raising the leader who will be able even to lead this nation to another position. So this is where we are, and we are trusting God for a greater thing.
Okay. Well, what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put up a picture of some animals that are walking on the sidewalk. And when I see these animals walking on the sidewalk, I see just a sign of unity. Not only do they know that it's not safe to walk in the streets, but the animals are walking on the sidewalk, and there were different kinds of animals. And so and they're different colors. So they're walking together side by side. And I'm thinking, if the animals know how to come together, surely we as a people can be united if only we would try. So thank you so much for that work. As that picture continues to be shown, I'm going to share just a message with you here. And these are 15 blessings that I pray that you will experience. Is that one? Is that I pray that you that hear the blessings to culminate your year. May your memories of past trials dissipate with each new day. May your joy exacerbate the frustrations of your enemies. May your witness for Christ educate others near and far. May your genuine love permeate society. May your confidence and courage eradicate all fears. May your strength humiliate your opponents. May your humility instigate others to examine their attitudes. May your peace illuminate your trust in God. May your God vindicate you when you're unjustly accused. May your hunger and thirst for truth and righteousness cause you to salivate. May your quest for understanding motivate you to seek God's face. May your experiences of his greatness and goodness activate your worship. May your knowledge of God annihilate unbelief. May your victories over circumstances lead you to celebrate. And may your patient hope prompt you to participate in praising God now. We don't have to wait until the battle is over. We can shout now because God truly is in control. What are your closing comments of encouragement? Speak to us now, just from your heart. From all the things you've seen, you've got about 3 minutes or so. From all the things you've seen, the things you witnessed, how people have come in struggling and you were able to help them. You were able to help them in their marriages. You were able to help them in their financial situation and just even with housing. Tell us then some words, some encouragement that would cross continents and be uplifting to us today.
Come on. According to the book of Proverbs 4:13, it reads, take fast hold of thy instruction. Let her not go. Keep her, for she is thy life. And the message that I would like to give unto you, whoever is listening unto us, is how do we break a toiling spirit? Sometimes we feel we are down. Sometimes we feel there is no hope. But I can see the writer of the book of Proverbs, full of the wisdom, he says many people are languishing in lack, poverty, evil treat, because they refuse to adhere to simple instructions. There are four parts to the verse we must apply to our life. Number one, first hold instruction. People, they don't want to be instructed. People, they don't want to be given instruction, guided. And that's why you see not only America, but all over the world, this time that we are living, people, they are not getting the word instruction upon their life. Yeah. So number one, if you are going to recover, we need to get the instruction. And the Bible says that foolish from human standpoint, but when and here too will turn you into a winning at all times. So number one, we need to hearken unto instruction. And second, let her not go. That is, whatever you have received, you are not supposed to abandon. I don't know whether in America it's like a Kenya, you can give somebody the written paper. Instead of reading and looking what it says, they just drop down. So you need to get whatever you are getting. And the book of Jeremiah 3:15 says, I will give you a pastor after my heart, yes, to feed you and to guide you. So you can see there is somebody the Lord will give you to guide you. Even each and every person needs somebody for a guidance. And number three, keep her. Whatever you receive, keep. The Bible says we should not just be the hearer, but we need to become the doer of the word. And number four, be thy guide and guide. This means that according to the book of Proverbs 4:6, it says a powerful word that we need also to learn how to know that we can only go against our enemy. As I have decided, poverty, sicknesses, and all everything, it is because lack of instruction. So there is a benefit of following godly instruction.
Yes.
I would encourage our dear brothers, wherever you are, you need somebody to give you instruction. And that, I believe that God has appointed me and the leaders. We are working together that we may give the people, wherever we are, the true instruction of God so that they may see the goodness of God in this world and the world to come.
All right. Hallelujah. That's a good word, and we're closing on that word. Thank you so much, Pastor George Thiong'o, in the Reuben slums of Nairobi, Kenya, at Agape Christian Fellowship Church. We really appreciate you sharing with us words of encouragement today and also teaching us about your own country and your ministry. May God continue to bless you and your wife as you lead the people to Him and also into the rich land that He has in store for us. Thank you so much for listening, everyone who's on the phone right now.
My wife is here. My wife is here. She can sing a word.
We have to close right now, but thank you so much for listening. May the good news bless your heart today. Remember, Jesus loves you, and I'm praying for you, and have a blessed day.
they may not play this on the radio, 'cause the devil don't want you to know. If we don't stop the hypocrisy, the nation will lose its soul. They'd rather play music about money and sex, like we don't have no intellect. Somebody need to show some respect.